Today's the 31st of October 1992. This is a recording of an interview between
Joan Hayes
and Ruby Langford Ginibi.
That's your Aboriginal name, is it?
Ginibi is a tribal name that my tribal aunt, the only remaining member of my father on Boxer's Mission Korokai, where I was born, gave me in 1990. Ginibi means swan, black swan.
Oh, right. How do you spell it?
G-I-N-I-B-I.
Right.
Ginibi.
Mm. So, do you mind me asking, what's your year of birth?
1934. 26th of January, actually. Shame day.
Really?
I was born on shame day.
Yeah.
That's what we Kuris call it, 26th of January. Yeah.
Did you go to the big march a few years ago, 1988?
Yeah, I travelled in
good,
a bus at the back of the march.
Did you?
No. Yeah, 1988. Yeah.
Yeah, and that big one in Sydney where they had amazing, wasn't it, how many people were there?
Yep, it was the first time all our people have ever come together in this country like that, from all over. They came. They travelled in convoys of busloads and carloads and God knows what.
Would you make a guess at how many?
There were 40 to 50,000.
Yeah,
that travelled.
Really?
Koori, Murrays, Noongars, Geelong, a whole lot. So each different
area. Koori is different to Murray?
Yeah, well Murray is Queensland Aboriginals.
Right.
New South Wales and Victoria are Kooris.
Oh,
South Australia people identify themselves or define themselves as Noongars. West Australia they're Noongars.
Mm.
That's Muddy and Ernie Dingo's country.
Oh,
no. Noongars they're called.
Mm.
And the Northern Territory they call them Yolong. I can't even pronounce that properly, but Geelong. Yeah.
What was your place of birth?
Boxridge Mission, Korokai.
Korokai.
Coast of New South Wales.
What's your current address?
18 Hewlett Street, Granville. Alawa Hostel. That means stop, sit down and rest a while.
Ah, nice.
It's the first hostel for Aboriginal older people ever in New South Wales.
Oh, is it? There's
hostels all over, but they're for younger people. This is the first one for older
people.
Oh, I see. Older groups, yeah. Oh. We've got an 90-year-old fella here. He's the oldest. I'm 58 going on 70 myself.
And have you been here long?
I'm the longest standing resident. I've been here for 5 years since it was opened in February of 1987. And I came here in August. 11th of August, 1987.
Mm. And it belongs to the hostels?
It belongs to Aboriginal Hostels Limited. They own the building, and it's leased by Aboriginal Medical Services.
Oh, I see.
Mm. We can accommodate 10. There's two respite care beds, but the rest are permanent residents. Mm. We've got 6 here already.
Oh.
We've had up to 9. Mm. We've got 24-hour-a-day staff. No, this by hand. No, it's a first, and it's great. I've just finished renovating it not long ago.
Mm.
We've been away from here in a hostel over the back for about 3.5 to 4 months. All done, you know. The whole lot. Rewired, painting, new bathrooms, so, and wall heaters, you know.
And there's no way that you can lose it, like, if the government changes.
It's owned by the hostels, isn't it? Yeah. There's no way we can lose it because it's owned by Aboriginal hostels.
Yeah. When you started writing, when you wrote "I'll Take You Love the Town," and where did you live then?
I lived in 2 Victoria Street, Marrickville, when I first picked up pen to write that book. I was on the 23rd of May, 1984. For 4.5 years, plus one nervous breakdown for writing up all this. I was recovering from major surgery in March of 1987, and I was doing rewrites for the manuscript from my hospital bed.
Jeez.
It pulled the guts out of me.
Mm-hmm.
But I was doing the rewrites of the deaths of my 3 kids, you know.
Yeah.
It was like as I was in mourning all over again.
Yes.
But everything in that book, it's all factual. I know because I've got the scars to prove it.
Yeah.
you know?
Yeah.
But I'm going to say then 4.5 years it took, and it came out on the 23rd of May, no, 23rd of November. It'll be 4 years old next month.
Mm-hmm.
And it's in a strip print.
Yeah,
the HSC next year should have been in there in 1991.
Mm-hmm.
But next year is the year of the Indigenous people of this country, so should do good.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, because of nothing being taught about our people, that's the reason why I picked up pen to write that book.
Yeah.
I thought of people, mostly non-Aboriginal, knew how hard it is for Aboriginal people to survive between the two castes in this country.
Mm.
They wouldn't be so damn racist, you know?
Yeah, especially the person.
Because there's nothing. I mean, there's a hundred books. I've been researching now for the last 8, going on 9 years since I picked up pen to write that book.
Mm.
And most of the writings about Aboriginal people, there's 100 books every year that come out about Aboriginal people in this country.
Mm.
And most of it's written by white academics and anthropologists who every time they dig a bigger hole, we've been here longer type thing and having us under a microscope. And big shot book writers who ripped us off for the sake of a glorious fact. And I was. Not that you can say anything about it just between you and me.
Yeah.
I was ripped off for half the copyright of that book. Well, my editor. And she got $26,000 before the book even hit the bloody streets, so she's made more money out of it than I ever have in here. But you know, and it's because it was my first venture into the world of literature, white man's literature, to get amongst them. I didn't know any of the rules of the game, but I was out there amongst the sharks, and they're all there to take great big bites of you. If you live at them, you don't know anything about
them. Did she feel bad about that?
Huh?
Do you think she feels?
Well, it took me 2.5 years of fighting her through. This cost me $1,300 in solicitor's fees to get the copyright back. And because she wouldn't front me in an open court. So I could take her to the cleaners. She had a piece of paper that I'd signed stating that if I died today, everything that comes from that book,
30
years after I'm dead, would go to her. And then they go to my kids. That's outrageous. And this has been happening to our people for a bloody long, long time. What she did was say, she shook my hand. She was introduced to me by the first person who ever read the drafts of my manuscript, whose name was Billy Marshall Stanting. He's a Yank. So he was traveling with the film crew with the ABC that came up to the Northern Territory to see Ayers Rock. The film, us urban coolies going up there in 1985.
Yeah.
And somebody told me that he was a writer and producer stuff like him. I bailed him up one of the little morning tea breaks on the road to Ezra and asked him, would you like to read my manuscript? I said, I've written my life story. Would you like to have a look at it and tell me what you think? So he read it when we came back to Sydney and said, this is quite good, but I feel you should work with a woman editing and show you how to structure it and that, you know? He introduced her to her, saying that she was a friend of his, but he never knew what motive she had, you know. She just saw dollars and cents signs sticking out of eyes. Well, we've got to get on to, you know, way it went. But she said to me, and like Bill was not aware of what she was doing, you know, what her motive was, and he didn't find out for a long time after. But until after we'd finished and everything was sent away, the manuscript to Penguin Books, he didn't know what her motives were, see, but she said to me, because she knew that she was an editor, she was a writing teacher, 17 years standing. She said, I've got a good lawyer and he'll get the best contract from Penguin for us.
Yeah.
And I said, okay, well, I'll leave it up to you. And I only ever went to second form high school, and that's class 2F, actually. That's a long way from bloody AB, and you know? The rest of the education was gotten in the school of bloody hard knocks and there's no better teacher. So anyhow, she bought a lawyer and I only met him, I think, twice. And he said, are you in agreement with me handling? I said, oh, yes, well, Sue, you know, I don't understand any of that.
Yeah.
But Sue, if you look after, yes.
Yeah.
point. Their motives were for just greed anyhow, you know. She should have advised me, or he should have advised me, that I should have had a separate lawyer.
Yes.
And I thought, she kept talking to me and saying, well, I've edited your work for you, and I think I've done a good job, and I feel like I should have some royalties. And I said, oh, of course, have some royalties.
Yes.
Not knowing that royalties and copyright were one and the same thing. I said, but you can't have copyright. Copyright's my story. That's a black woman's story.
Yes.
You can have some royalties, but you can't have that.
No.
But she knew what she was doing.
And
this has to manipulate.
So
anyhow, it took all the joy of the coming out of that first book of mine.
Mm.
And it's opened up a lot of people's hearts and minds as to the Aboriginal question in this country today.
Mm.
Because there's everything in that, from a mission bedside person's story, and it also shows, it knocks down some of the stereotypes about our people just being lazy, lay about drunken bums, you know?
Mm.
This is how we have the stereotypes. But I'm saying, these people, you know, the big shot writers that have written about us like every year and that, how they write and perceive us to be is the thing that perpetuates and keeps alive the racism and stereotyping of Aboriginal people in this country today.
Yeah.
So this is why I take the opportunity to talk to people like you, because you at least have the decency enough to come and ask from the grassroots level.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, well, I'm thrilled that you're going to be here.
And this Aboriginal education, if it had been brought into the school curriculum way back then, our people wouldn't be dragging the bloody chain behind everybody in this country today.
Yeah.
They're bringing in Japanese and Asian languages to be taught compulsory,
and
multiculturalism,
and
we are still being overlooked in our own land, and it's a big shame, you know. And so when I can talk and tell people how it really is, from a Puri perspective, and the truth's got to come out, the truth will come out one day, but we are an oppressed people.
Mm.
We've always been, and we've always had to conform to the standards of the invaders in this country. We've had to learn the Queen's English best we can, because Aboriginal education was not available till relatively recently.
Mm.
We weren't allowed into mainstream schools because of racist attitudes towards our people, you know?
Mm.
I think 1945 was the first year that they started allowing Aboriginal children. I've got a whole thing out there I'll show you in a minute. You can help. I mean, I'm not out to make a buck out of any of this stuff. It's just that I want the truth to be known, so it will promote a better understanding, because there has to be a coming together of the two cultures in this country.
Yes.
We're not going to go away, you know. We've been here forever and ever, and our history goes back to infinity, and we're the first people of this land, and this country has to accept that,
and
recognise it, you know.
Yes.
But I'm going to say, there's so much that's gone against us. You won't see any of our black faces running around on those television programs there.
Mm.
They use exotic people who've even taken to colouring up whites to play Aboriginal roles. And we've got this wonderful source of human resource here, and it's been here forever, but it's only ever been used and exploited.
Yeah.
It's never been fostered, but they use our images to promote this country for tourism, for big bucks.
Mm.
But it's a country that we don't have no say in. We don't have a voice.
Mm.
We've only got to look to see what that is. The Charles Perkins, right?
Mm.
And he was the one that should have been our first Aboriginal minister.
Mm.
You know? Mm. I mean, people say to me, what are you? You're a writer or a politician? Well, I'm both. We have always been a political football in this country. And like whichever government comes into power, they pass our portfolios around Aboriginal affairs from one to the other.
Mm.
And this is another thing that keeps us as lowest of the low too.
Yeah.
But they're not really interested in Aboriginal people as people.
Yeah.
You know? Mm. Why don't they hand the portfolios back to black people so we can handle our own affairs?
Mm.
You know? Because we are two separate people.
What do you think about, tell me what you think about ATSIC.
ATSIC?
Yeah.
You really want to tell me? I think we've got well-trained black bureaucrats that are doing to us exactly what the governments have done all our lives. They suppress, not only suppress, but control our people exactly the same way.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
So you don't think there's a future with it?
Oh, there might be a future with it if they can get rid of all the uptown niggers.
Yeah,
you know?
Because they,
you know what I mean?
Yeah, well, they're voting.
Yeah.
You know, you voted
every... Yeah, they've got to be voted in. Because there's been a lot of rip-offs and stuff like that in our land councils and things like that, and misappropriation of funds and things like that. But then you look at it from another way too. Our people have bloody good teachers. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
They had bloody good teachers to teach them to be like that.
You can't expect that things are going to sort themselves out.
We're gonna make mistakes and things like that. Because, as I said, we have never had access to education in the mainstream system until relatively recently. So we've got a lot of catching up to do.
That's right.
And even today, the 90s, we've got older ones like me going back and doing courses to get their degrees and stuff like that, you know. And that's wonderful to see. It's through the education that we're going to be able to lift ourselves up.
Yeah.
But we don't want white guilt. It's a negative attitude. We want positive stuff. People to come together to help us lift ourselves out of this.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Which is a big shame on the country. Big shame on this country because it does not acknowledge Aboriginal people whatsoever.
Mm.
We don't have no positions of power in this country.
Mm.
We don't have a voice.
Mm.
And that's wrong.
Mm.
We still have white bureaucrats in Canberra making decisions for us, like if we don't have a brain in our heads to think that, and this is morally wrong, you know?
With the election to that city, does that come every 3 years or every year?
I don't really know that much about it. I haven't got involved with that. So going just to go to vote, you know, to vote the ones in that we think will be fair and decent.
Mm.
But it may work out well. Well, it's a better way of having control of funding and see what's going down.
Mm.
So we've got another
national
process.
Body, isn't it?
We've got, and it's for every state.
Yes.
So it may work out well, but our people have got to get together and tell these ones that are in the power, look. Bugger off and cut out the, you know, don't be like a coconut in Western. You're doing to us what the whole system has always done to us. We don't need that sort of shit. We've got to come together as a people on a fair and equal footing so that we can get ahead and do what we've got to do, you know. And we will win out in the end because we are the indigenous people of this country. And as I said, our history's gone back as far as infinity, you know.
And
the Aboriginal spirit in this country will never die.
No, it will never die.
It's in the land, and it's coming out in our kids. Look at the artworks in my room. See this?
Yeah.
It's painted by my son that's in jail. Look, there's Everly Street. Look, there's one of our if you read Real Deadly, that's Max Silver, who was our black magic man of music.
Oh,
and that's his spirit rising above Everly Street, Redfern. Look.
No.
This is the spirit of my three dead kids, up here, painted by my son. This is the Hands of Hope. Look, that's my daughter that made history being the first Aboriginal ever to dance with any province in Australia. That's Pearl. It was 1969. That's my extended family, my tribal grandmother, on the mission in Box Ridge. That was painted by my son from a photograph. And see the old outer station house there, down the bottom? That was the original cookhouse at Main Camp Homestead, which was the first place that my grandfather worked with across the border into New South Wales in the 1840s. So we've got a history that this country has to recognise. And it's as valid as anything. My adopted girl, who's doing her doctorate. Now that's her up there. And see her in the corner, and there, look, behind me. Yeah. She's got her MA, and she's doing her doctorate. Pam Johnson.
How do you mean
adopted
girl?
Well,
you adopted her.
Black fellow adopted.
No.
Not white fellow adopted. You know, I'm not
really
like just adopted.
Yeah, you're very good friends.
Yeah. But I pass her as a daughter.
Mm-hmm.
That's how we are. We've got our family kinship last name, you know.
How did you name?
Well, Penguin Books wanted, I had half say in the design of the cover of my first book, and I wanted an Aboriginal design to show that it was done by, it was fully work, and she was one of the artists that I got a phone number off and called, and she came and had a go. at doing it, and so did Dan Eastwood with the other artists. But they Penguin knocked back their two designs, but they settled on this. And what does that say to you? That's they're Mimi spirits.
Oh.
The spirits of the dream. Okay? Now what is that little scene that's going on there? This is why it was appropriate for the cover of my book. Besides, it wouldn't have cost Penguin nothing because it was by an unknown artist that. But what does that little scene say to you there?
I don't know.
Come here, I'll show you. Look. A mother giving birth.
Yeah.
One in front helping her deliver and one supporting
her.
Back.
Mm-hmm.
The other two are dancing for joy.
Ah.
So it's birth,
yeah.
Life.
Mm-hmm.
And I was having a rave on any other chapter.
Mm-hmm. What do you think of people saying bad luck?
Huh?
What do you think about that, you know, the bad luck, the ultimate bad luck?
Ah, that's the way to sell it. Well, I am a battler.
Yeah.
I live out bloody through the life, should I?
It's a very Aussie word, battler.
Well,
yeah. I don't think it's a bad word.
No. But that's Billy. You see, that's his writing, battler. But
come here and I'll battle you.
And you read some of Ruby?
Yes,
Ruby.
I have, yeah.
Well, I'm going to say, there's 18 stories in that, short stories. And I think there's 8 poetry pieces in there.
Mm.
So I write poetry too, you know. And,
one of the things I really like about what I've read is the way you describe things. It's like you're there. But there's one scene that I really remember where I think it was around sitting somewhere when you went back home and had a shower and it was raining or something and you went to bed and you were talking about lying in bed.
Well, you see, lots of people don't define my writing in your wide academic sense as literature, because I write orally, like
mm-hmm.
I talk.
Mm.
It's a good thing I can bloody well, you
yeah,
know what I mean?
Yeah, we'll see.
So, well, we're coming from an oral history,
yeah.
Where our stories and our poems, the whole bit's been handed down by word of mouth.
Yeah.
But we've had to conform.
Yeah.
To the standards of the oppressor in this country, to learn the Queen's English,
yeah.
So that we can write, so that people can comprehend what
yeah.
they're talking about.
Yeah.
You see what I mean?
Yeah.
But we've always had to be the ones to conform to another set of standards that weren't our own.
Yeah.
You know? We've always had to conform. We weren't allowed to be ourselves.
Mm.
We've always been controlled by the government. And with
how
the things that are coming out of the...
How would you do it differently?
Huh?
How would you do it differently? What would you say if you wanted to tell those stories? Like, I mean, I suppose ideally it's the storytelling. It's the telling people more than writing it down.
Yeah, but my poems, you can't consider some of them as poems because they're done poetry as opposed to rhyme. Mine is classified mostly as prose,
yeah.
Because with prose, it doesn't rhyme, but it makes statements in it.
Yeah.
You listen to this one. I'll read the little one, eh?
Mm.
Now this is what I... Owed to the rich and river and the Bundjalung people, you were a source of abundant food for my people, the Bundjalung tribes. Your shores, Bungawalban, Jackalwalban, Minimai, Korokai, Uraji, all surrounded by a place known as the Big Scrub. Plenty bush tackle around, Bunny, Bingi, Wurrubit. No more do warriors hunt and bring home nunging, so that our family clans can eat. Gone all our tribal ways, only 3 elders left. All old Dubes, no old Nabba to tell us our stories and legends, or to give us our laws. No more corroborates, no more singing, no more clapsticks, no more bull tell me of initiation, no more digging for yams with yam sticks, only broken down homes with paint peeling and fences falling down, and cars to go counting on, fencing and down with those for shopping. A basketball court were once a garden room, only little hall for land council meetings where they sit and argue about no funds to lift our living standards up. No more mission schools, bus comes are taken into town school, not allowed in a long time ago. Lots of changes since time long gone, some good, some bad. No jobs around for bagel or debate or jargon too, now that the place has been colonised and settled. Only boredom, unemployment and poverty, and drinking white man's booze. Big landowners that dispossess them of the land and everything, living in mansions on the hills, away from the flood riches of the old Richmond River, selling Murray Grey cattle to live in affluence, while the Bunjalung people who worked and built up those big cattle stations as cooks, stockmen, housemaids and servants survived in time warp, living in fourth world conditions in poverty compared to the affluence of the mansions on the hills. And these are the end notes of footnotes. Bunnings means porpoise. Bingy means turtle. Woolaby, koala. Jardins means children. Nullan means grandfather. Duane, Aboriginal woman. And Nunnan, Kaka. So see? And for me to be able to write my big basement and make, put the statements into my writing, it comes across with that extra year of hunt, which is making people aware that this is true. This is what I found when I went back to the mission after a 48-year absence to find my roots. This is how my people are still living compared to...
Where is that?
The Yabsmiths, yes. Michael Yabsmith's ancestors were the dispossessors of my people. They're the ones I'm talking about that are living in mansions on the bloody hill. I interviewed his mother up there at, to the fella that she married the second time round for the Michael Yabsmith's father died. And not only my grandfather, but a whole lot of people on the mission where I was born worked for those people at one time or other. And they built those big properties up. You know? And yet you look at them today, you can see this woman walking around up there in 30 degrees heat, and she had glasses and stockings on, and hair not on her face, and made up real deadly, you know? And it was corgi running around the bloody ankles.
How come you went up there?
Oh, well, I was chasing my roots, wasn't I?
And you went to the house?
Yeah, I made an appointment to see them. The fellow I talked to, her second husband, grew up with my father and his brothers and sisters. Mm. You know? Yeah. And my grandfather gave them 30-odd years of his life.
So the condition was linked to the...
They gave the Kuli people 10 acres ground in the back of Kolokai. And they owned all the big states, all those names of these properties that I, this is some of them that they owned. They owned Kulum Kulum was the name, Minyamaya. Minyamaya means place of plenty, plenty bush duck, plenty duck, you know, of all sorts. Fish, the whole lot. Gibraji, that his mother was known. Bungawoven, that was another property. They were all named for properties and places. That's not what they are. They have these big horses. But the Aboriginal people never ended up for nothing. They're still sitting there in poverty compared to those people that took the land over, you know? They're sitting in mansions on the hill with everything. What they need. Down here, look.
When you interviewed them, what did you say?
I found she was really condescending and so. She was one of the original welfare officers who used to take the kids and put them into the bloody house. When I asked her for the files on how many children were taken from there, I told her what I was doing. I write in history of my people and I'd like to know this, you know. She rang me up when I come back to Sydney to say that she couldn't find them. She thinks she gave them away to some somebody else that was doing some research, it's just that she did not want to be connected in any way or taken the children, but what that was just being able to do. Hard to do, and it makes them wild.
And did you end up having an
argument? No. I just picked their brain.
Oh, right.
Well, he was lovely. I could see that he, when he, see, he spoke about my grandfather,
yeah.
Who was one of the two Aboriginal cricketers ever in the whole of Australian history to get sent on a bread and out for a bat, and he called him the Black Bastard, you know.
Uh-huh.
Grandfather was going to hit him with a bat. Uh-huh. And that was handed down to me by word of mouth.
Yeah.
You know, but I was only a little girl when grandfather used to do the cricketing like that, so I didn't grow up with it. I was taken off the mission and that. But he was a legend. And the only reason why he didn't wear the green and gold of Australia in the cricket was because he was a black man. You know? And it's disgusting. It's disgusting. Now with all this stuff going down about the Olympics and how they've got a consent from the Aboriginal officers, which is a lot of bullshit, they don't consult with our people on anything. They have never consulted with our people on any matters like this before. So why run now when there's something that's going to bring more money into this country and recognise our people when they happen to fall in the past? It's a lot of shit.
Mm.
You know? And that's wrong.
Yeah, and what, is that developing Homebush or what?
And the Aboriginal Legal Service has taken it up and said, while ever there's poverty and our people are on the lowest rung of the social ladder in this country and don't have human rights, why should we consent to this, you know? They've never ever worried about asking us before. Why should they want to ask now?
Yeah.
When they just go over our bloody heads and do it anyhow, you know?
Yeah.
Do what they want, they've done it all alive. But they know, because the outside world is watching this country because of this racist attitude to Aboriginal people. And the fact is, fact. I can only write it like, tell it like it really is, you know?
Were you up in Queensland with the Commonwealth Council?
No, I wasn't. What year was that now?
Yeah,
80. I don't remember. 80, what was it? What year was it? 80, was it 83?
Or 83, yeah, I think it was early 80s.
82 or something like that.
They say it was an incredible time.
But I'm going to say, our people don't get any acknowledgement for having any input into this country. And let's face it, the first squatters would never have been able to survive in this country without Aboriginal bloody involvement. As I said, they were housemates, cooks, servants, a bloody lot, you know?
I mean, it's a bit like Australia was there, the Humboldt colony. A lot of the people that came here, 180,000 or something, transported. And a lot of them only did one thing, you know?
There's a little statement that I've put into everything, that every history paper that I've ever written. I've written quite a few. And it goes like this. The people who colonised this country were not the cream of the British aristocracy.
No.
They were the dregs of an oppressed society.
Mm.
They brought that oppression here and oppressed our Aboriginal people with it. They were the builders of jails and prisons.
Yeah.
And in 204 years, the mentality hasn't changed. The only change being is that the oppressors are on top and are the bosses, and our people are still floundering down here 20 to 30 years behind everybody in all the basic human rights needs. And that's fact, is fact, too.
Yeah, Australia, I reckon we haven't
still
acknowledged our own
history.
We can't even look that far.
That's right.
You know,
that's right. But you still, you come out the bottom of the country, we're still nowhere.
Yeah.
So you're still up.
Well, accepting, I mean, like a lot of things, the way a lot of people, like white people, what voted once every 3 years and all that.
Yeah.
And a lot of, like now we've got all this multinational thing. Well, you know, we've got Americans,
and
we've got Japanese.
More trouble, the price knows what else. But the Aboriginal people have never ever seen our sovereignty in this country to any person, you know? And so they have to come to terms with the fact that we are the indigenous people and give us our sovereign right.
Before this country can call the second nation.
And of course they're bringing multiculturalism, of course, you know? Uh, when they're going to go that way to the Pacific, to their islands and other places like there, to get more trade and stuff like that, because America doesn't give a stuff about us, it's killing us dead with our wheat and stuff like that. You see, but our country is forever, instead of looking after its own, we're ever sucking up to the big powers.
Yeah.
You know, instead of getting ourselves and pulling ourselves out of the rut.
Because it's always those international pressures. Like, I suppose that's what, I mean, with the English competing with the Spanish and to get Australia.
I mean, yeah, well, look, let's face, there were people that came here long before Cook ever hit the shore, but they came and they went. They did not come to dispossess a people of their land or their dream.
They would have.
They
would have.
And besides, the old one always said that when the white people came, they welcomed them with open arms because they thought that in their tribal way they were the spirits of their dead coming back to them. And yet look at all this shit that we've had to put up with for this long, and it's disgusting. You know?
Do you know that book, The Day the Sky Fell Down? It's a big volume. It's about Sydney.
I read something when I was in hospital with my daughter gave me, called Look Dad the Hanging Grandpa, and I laughed my bloody head off at it. I always read a book for him, you know.
I do, so you like reading.
Huh?
You like reading.
I'll have a look.
Well, I'll tell you what, I'll try and get a copy of that.
Yeah.
It's called this The Day the Sky Fell Down.
Yeah. Look Dad the Hanging Grandpa, that's written by, I don't even know the name of the fellow, I can remember it. Gilbert Anstruther, and it was an Australian Aussie fellow talking to an American and trying to tell him about the history of the settlement of Australia. And when Governor Phil flew into Sydney Cove, this is one of the instances, it was 1788 or whenever he hit the year, but when he came into Sydney Cove, he went out onto the deck and he could smell, you know. Our people were having a big cookout, a room read over on the shore. And poo, the fog's high. And that's how they got the man Bondi.
Really?
That's in this book.
Bondi.
Another excerpt was there was a picture drawn of an Aboriginal standing on one leg. You know how they stand with the knee like this?
Yeah.
And says, why do you think that fellow is standing on one leg? And the answer was, in the same book, he's trying to put the other leg down and stand on two feet because he might be treading on somebody else's bloody private property. And there's another one about Emu Plains, how Emu Plains got his name. Back from Wentworth and Lawson, and our mob showed them the way over that bloody Blue Mountains too. But anyhow, Mrs. Lawson wanted some bread, so on a Sunday it was. She said, the baker cooks on the Sunday for the Monday, so would you go and get a loaf of bread for tea? And away he went. He was walking down, coming down the Blue Mountains, and he saw this great big emu laying in the middle of the road, and she was crying. What's the matter, Mrs. Emu? And she said, oh, Mr. Wentworth, she said, I'm crying because I'm a plain emu and the male emus won't have anything to do with me. That's how they got the name Emu Plains. This is this book, you see.
I wonder if they're true.
He was trying to explain to this gang about Bob Menzies, he would be Prime Minister forever.
What's that called?
Huh?
What's it called, that one?
Look, Dad, the Hanging Grandpa.
The Day the Sky Fell Down.
Yeah.
They tell the story, I don't know if it's true, but they tell the story that the reason why, that when the whites first came, what you said, that the Aboriginal people thought that, because they believed in the spirits, and they thought that all the spirits, all the white people, were like the spirits of their ancestors, because that's how people are always spirits of ancestors. And so they didn't want to
and welcomed them with open arms, you know? Mm. Yeah, that's good.
They say that there was this belief that the ancestors were in the sky, and the reason why they think the sky fell down is because the sky had fallen down, and all these ancestors had come down all at once.
Oh, right.
So the sky had fallen down, and that's why there were so many all at one place. But the thing that I don't understand about that is that, you know, that thing about the dream places and the spirits come from under the ground.
You know what the dream time means?
Oh, not really.
Well, the dream time is before creation time, before the earth was created. Which will tell you how long our culture goes back. Was when the spirit forces moved out of the land, creating the physical force, the mountains, the valleys, the trees, everything, you know?
Yeah.
That was the dream time.
Yeah,
it's before creation.
You know that 18 years book? And it's got all the pictures. Oh, it's a beautiful book.
Yeah.
It's got all the... I mean, I don't know how true they are, but it's got the story.
Yeah.
And then 18 years drew a picture based off a story.
Yeah,
the dream times. And there's one that I really... One that I think of is this, and when they drew the picture on the story. Was it like a bunny?
Yeah.
The story is the animal's like a bunny. Like the link between the myth of the bunny and
the legend. Yeah. Well, see, all the legends and stuff like that and the myths and that, they were handed down to our people from generation to generation.
Mm-hmm.
I know quite a bit about the stuff of mine, my people, tons of other people, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I can remember being told the legends of Garvan, the Garvan, old cranky woman.
Mm-hmm.
And it's written in that book.
Mm-hmm.
Legend of Garvan. And years ago, when we were kids, we were never able to use that word. We could speak it just before.
Mm-hmm.
And she was a witch woman of the creation period.
Mm-hmm.
She hit the water because her son-in-law, Balladin, she didn't like it. So she was cranky and angry. She hit the water. To get a better balance, and then from the right leg ran the Richmond River, and this was how the Gundaban tribes were formed. So the Richmond River ran that way, and it ran, and they meet. The Richmond and the Clowns, they would meet before they go into the ocean.
Yeah,
Ballina. Yeah,
I read that story, and my parents were at Ballina.
Yeah.
So I thought I would tell them that one.
That's just one of the legends. There's even still today, there's sacred places, you know. The spirits of our people are still there. Nimbin Rocks.
Oh.
Nimbin Rocks was a place where our clever ones, a weird garlic, was taught to levitate and fly, show their spirits. And it's a burial place. It's not a woman's restaurant. And people that go there have bad dreams. But the spirits are still with us here. The sacred place. And our old elder, I'm really bored, will never go there unless she's the keeper of that place now, because all old men are gone. She's the other one that looks after, she's the keeper. And before she goes in there, she balances, sing out in the lingo and talk to the old ones that are coming in for have a look or show some people. And that they won't be long. And then his wife are going. And when they go, they pick a big branch, a big tree. And say that that place is to my people.
Where's it coming?
Nimbin Rock. And Buena Headland, another sacred place. There are over a massacre of over 100,000 of my people, men, women and children, were murdered there by the settlers. with the stale five sheep, there were hundreds, but they thought it was fair. The rest, the white men had fenced off the land, and they've had access to the cattle. So the children.
What do you think about monuments going on?
Huh?
What do you think about monuments going on those spots? Where do you think that's a different thing?
I think people just should respect what's there and should know.
They should know. In that way, if a monument is there, if they do, it's a way that you can identify the place.
Yeah. Well, a lot of our people don't want those places to be identified.
They don't.
By people and have people stamp and all those.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
But some places, yes. Well, one headland, Master Place, it is a bundle of National Park.
Oh.
And it's a place where people can go and picnic and have barbecues and stuff. But the old ones, from the mission, my old people, our grannies, those old ones, go there and have a look and have a picnic. With our ones or comments or remarks in that month. You see, in our, this is the difference between us, in our Aboriginal way, there's no such thing as coincidence.
Yeah.
No such thing as coincidence. What's going to happen to that? You know? And that's a funny thing. Me going back 48 years, I was 8 years old when I left Boxer's Mission Club. I find my roots. I was compelled to write the book.
Yeah.
I'm compelled to do what I'm doing now.
Yeah.
The book.
Yeah.
To promote a better understanding.
Yeah.
You know? But after being away for all the time and going back there to that mission, I was crying around every corner I went because the memories were so painful for us. You know? There's a bathhouse kitchen costing so much water because the water was precious. We only had tank water. We had no town water, you know. And every Monday morning, how the nose and we take them sulfur and molasses, raw sulfur. I'm allergic to sulfur in any form today. And because of my stupid old chest, you know, I should have sulfur. And it would kill my chest, make my chest better, but I can't, I'm allergic to it because of what they've done down there. Gosh, when we were kids, you know. There were atrocious things that happened to our people. I can remember where to get around the protection to come to round up the kids. I'm going to scrap them high until they went. And little kids would be terrified.
Yeah.
And they started off taking the half-caste ones from as far back as when there were troopers in 1883, rounding them up on horseback up till 1969, the year they landed man on the moon. It's something like nearly 100 years, 80-something odd years of struggling children, you know, solely because they wanted a workforce, putting themselves back. But not only because they wanted a workforce, because they didn't want half-caste children growing up tribally, because our people were classed as heathen and vermin, being cleared off the face of the earth. And this is what they did to our people. And you can't do what has been done to a race of people like ours without having disastrous results. And how we are today is still floundering with the end result. And this country has to accept what it has a responsibility, you know. No more glossing over, no more bullshit and telling lies. This country was not fair as much, it's with our country. And yet we're still the most underprivileged in this land. But it has to be coming together, as I said, on a fair and muddy equal level.
Do you believe in treaty or do you think a treaty is?
I'm a bit worried about treaties, you know. A bit worried about treaties, but there has to be some form of recognition. But look at the treaty that they got in New Zealand, and look what happened to that model. But there's got to be some form of recognition. I mean, only 25 years down the track were we allowed to vote and be counted in the census.
Yeah.
That's only 25 years down the track.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And yet, now that they've got this multicultural thing, with everybody that comes to this country from all over the world, wherever they migrate from, they don't, those people, they don't give away their language or their culture. They sign a bit of paper to say that they're Australian bloody citizens.
Yeah.
And yet our people have been forced to deny our Aboriginality. We weren't allowed to use languages. We had to accept the white man's way of thinking and you know, live like white people. We had to, we were forced to be anything else but our bloody selves. And that's wrong. That's morally wrong. You know? And this country, before settlement, it supported something like 300,000 to 400,000 nomadic, semi-nomadic tribes people, hunter-gatherers in this continent. And yet, by the year 1920, after settlement, there were only 60,000 left.
Did you say
300,000 to 400,000? And
later
research has revealed that it's near the million mark.
Yeah.
300 Aboriginal nations were wiped out through the colonising of this country. And that's capitalist too.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. And people don't know these things. If they knew that perhaps we had a whole democratic, we had the most democratic form of society.
Yeah.
Everyone had a place. Nobody was excluded.
Yeah.
And with our laws, there were no kings and queens. We had tribal elders, the lawgivers. And if you bugged up and did the wrong thing, you were banished. And I mean, not only for a couple of days, banished for life. If the deed was foul, you were put up out there on the flat and they threw spears at you until you were dead. Oh, no bugger that. It's just And yet, today, look at our people. They're the most incarcerated in jail. None of the 300 and something recommendations from the Royal Commission into Aboriginal Deaths in Custody has been implemented. And for them to understand about poor people and why we are so, it shows you the racist society we live in. There has always been that hostility between Aboriginals and police. The police have always been the oppressors and they're supposed to be the protectors. And they used to provide the rations for Aboriginal people before some of the missions, you know, started. And they were protectors, prosecutors. It was a terrible role where they had to be all these three different sorts of things. I've got it written down at those, hey, but they had the power to do. They had this power over Aboriginal people. They've always had that power over Aboriginal people. And because the whole country knows nothing about Aboriginal culture, history, politics, the whole bit, they've got to come back to the grassroots level to find out what they're talking about. But mostly, for something to be done about this and custody, they've got to educate the police, they've got to educate the judiciary, they've got to educate lawyers, they've got to educate judges, and so that they know how Aboriginal people have been dispossessed in their own country. They've got to know this about us, and that perhaps will give them a better understanding as to why our people in country. Not because they're bad and evil people, it's just that the system does not. Aboriginal people have to conform to other laws and other rules when we had our own, you see? And we're still the ones that have had to conform to somebody else's standing. And we're still being punished. We want to know when the punishment's going to bloody end. And that's fact, in fact, too. When our boys are in jail, like they do with the Red Indians, they should have the elders go in there, and there are elders around, go in there and talk to our blokes, and our women are just as much incarcerated as what the men are. Oh, yes. They should have them go in there and teach the culture and the laws.
Why don't they do that?
Because they can't get permission to do it. Some of the jails, they can't even get permission to wear their bloody colours. My son used to put a poster up, put it up of the flag, the Koori flag, black, red and yellow. He was coming and ripped it down. You know, you've got a lot of racist people out there.
Yeah, you should do it, especially.
Oh, yeah, and things like that, yeah. This is what they need to do, is to get the elders going in there and talk to them and saying, hey, you don't have to get involved in all this silly stuff and get stuck behind these walls. Hey, look, you come from this rich culture. This is your roots, this is where you come from. You have a place.
Mm.
And talk to them and let them know.
Yeah.
And it should be taught like a religion.
Mm.
Well, it is our religion.
Yeah.
Aboriginal people have always had a spirituality, which was our religion before.
Mm.
We had missionaries ran religion down our throats. We always knew that there was a good spirit that looked after every living thing.
Mm.
And that we lived in unity with this land. We never destroyed this land. We backburned when the food chain was getting scarce and moved on. So that land would regenerate, and when the animals came back, so did the food chain. That's how they looked after. And today, white man's looking to Aboriginal ways of thinking to try and restitute himself from the damage that he's done with the whole nose and land, the whole bit, you know? So there's always been this human resource there, but it's never been acknowledged, only exterminated, massacred, genocide, shooting, you name it. It's always been.
There have been steps.
Look, things are changing, but things are changing, and they're changing very slowly. Now look, you see the bushpacker man, he goes up there and he picks the traditional ones of knowledge, all for the army and for that. I bet he gets the buck out of it, but what do they give back to my people?
Well, the land rights stuff, you know. I mean, that land, all that big property, isn't there, out west and all that, around the Darling River?
Well, look, Northern Territory people, Kuri ones, have got more land rights than us down here. Us yellow fellows, they call them, ones with a degree of caste. They've got more land rights than what we'll ever have. And here in New South Wales, land rights for us is Crown land that nobody wants and that's not being bloody used. And even then...
But then they bought those big properties, didn't they?
Oh, they bought some properties here.
Mm-hmm.
And they run them.
They run them.
They were the stockmen and that up there that worked and built them places up too.
Mm-hmm.
But it was taken over by investors for all the bloody years and things up there, the big cattle hierarchies and that, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. And they went on strike, the Grizzlies up there.
Yeah.
For fair wages and that, because...
Yeah.
They use them as their human resource to round up their stock and everything from mustard and that, do the hard, dirty work, and then when everything was settled down, they didn't want them no more, they just give a bit of flour and that to send them on their way. And the rest of the time they'd have to go and look for bush tucker.
Mm.
So what's that, you know? They have to give something back. You can't take forever.